So welcome everybody, assalamu alaikum, welcome to the LMYG program. My name is Jinan Al-Husseini, if you don't know me, and today we are welcoming a very special guest who has spoken with us before, Sister Isra Altayar. So Isra is a life coach and NLP practitioner. Maybe Isra, you could tell us a little bit about what that means. And today we're going to be talking about sort of topics relating to mental health and well-being, and trying to take control over your thoughts and emotions, and sort of different strategies on dealing with sort of emotional well-being and mental health, which is very much needed in this climate at the moment. So I'm sure we can all benefit, inshallah. So let's welcome Isra with a loud salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
So thank you again, Jinan, for the introduction, and thank you for inviting me here today. I have been to Leeds before to talk to some of you, and mashallah, you have an amazing community. I was telling Jinan just before we get started here, mashallah, I remember meeting the youth at the time. It was probably a couple of years ago maybe, but they were very interested, focused, intrigued, they inquisitive, which is really, really nice. So inshallah, I know you've all grown up, but inshallah, you'll still benefit from whatever I have to say today. So what is a life coach? So I think that's what Jinan wanted me to kind of point out. So a life coach is someone who kind of helps you through life, basically coaches you through life. And just like, I think the closest example is when you go to the gym, some of us have, if you go to the gym, you might have a personal trainer that helps you to manage everything, helps you how to build up your body and, you know, strengthen yourself physically. A life coach will help you to deal with whatever life throws at you. And sometimes what I do is, well, all the time what I do is I help people to discover themselves and get rid of any emotional baggage that they might have that's stopping them from moving forward in their life. And then we start to strategically help them to build up their life to be the best that they can be in their life. And that's the aim. I think all of us want to, you know, get out of this life the best that we can and be in our best self. So be happy, be fulfilled, and serve in the best way possible in this world. And that's what a life coach helps you do. NLP stands for neuro-linguistic programming, and it's just techniques that looks at the way you think and the way you talk, the linguistics, and how to reprogram the mind to achieve excellence. So a lot can be talked about that, but that's in brief what it is. So inshallah, today we'll cover exactly the topic that Jinan told you about. We'll talk through emotional well-being and how to actually take focus control of your emotions. And I'll keep it quite short, inshallah. I'll try my best. And then we'll open the floor to any questions. And inshallah, I aim to finish just before 7 o'clock, everything. So inshallah, then we'll have time to do everything. So what is emotions? I think this is a kind of a big topic of emotions, and we all might have different emotions at this time, especially with the Christmas break, being locked down for the last, you know, 7 months, a lot of ins and outs of what we can and can't do. So many things outside our control with the virus that it's kind of, it takes people emotionally in different ways, and people deal with these kind of environmental situations in different ways, but we all have different emotions maybe. And emotions, there's a nice analogy that's, I don't know where I read it, but it says emotions are energy in motion. So there's energy in everything. So when we talk about humans, we are composed of three things that we deal with. And that's our thoughts, our feelings, and our emotions. And their energy flows in all three, actually. And I always give kind of this chart. I'm not doing like a slideshow today because it stops me from seeing you, even though the majority don't have their cameras on. But our thoughts is the way we think. So that's our mind work. And the things that we think about, the things that we talk to ourselves, our inner dialogue, all of those are our thoughts. And our thoughts affects our feelings. So the way you feel, are you sad? Are you happy? Are you angry? Are you frustrated? These are all feelings that we have. And we associate it with the heart or the soul. And that affects your actions. So how you actually act. So your thoughts, your feeling affects the way you behave. And there's a, you know, kind of a correlation and a relationship between all these three things. So the way you think affects the way you feel. If you think positively, then you're bound to feel really positive and happy. And if you feel happy, you end up doing so many positive actions. Whereas the day that you wake up and you feel quite sad or frustrated, usually it means your energy is quite low. Your frequency of the energy that you have with those thoughts are quite low. So the feeling and the energy in those feelings are usually low frequency energies as well. And so your actions are, again, low frequency actions. So you can't possibly then perform your best. So energy is like a big topic that I can talk about for ages as well. But energy essentially flows in all these three things. And there are so many theories and, you know, talks about energy, and that we humans are energy in flow, basically. So, but always consider, I want you to always think about what your outcome is. So even today, what have you done today? What's your energy been like today? Have you had kind of a weekend, lazy weekend, or have you had a really productive weekend? Do you feel good about yourself and what you've done? Do you feel productive? All of those things. Look at your outcome of every single day. And then consider, go back and see what was the input to today and how did that affect my output? Okay, just like science, input, output, experiments that you do, whatever you put in, you get out. So, and what kind of reviewing what your energy was like from the beginning of the day and seeing how that affected the output that you produced or what you did during your day. So, and the other thing to consider is that I want you to all know that emotions are all good. There's no such thing. And sometimes we talk about negative emotions, but in actual fact, even when I say negative emotions, if I say those words, I don't mean them to be bad emotions. So all emotions are actually positive emotions and they all serve us in some way or form. And it's in our fitrah and it's in our nature to have all these emotions. So even when we talk about sadness, it's a positive feeling. It's there to serve something. When we talk about anger, it's a positive feeling. It's there to serve something. So when does emotion become bad or wrong or negative? It's when we lose control of the emotion. That's when it starts to affect us negatively. Not the emotion is negative, but the effect it has on us becomes negative. It's when we lose control of our sadness, where we are sad all the time, or we lose control of our anger that we start to lash out and get angry at people. So if somebody, for example, bullies us, if you get bullying at school or somebody says something that upsets us, we might feel sad or we might feel angry. And we then, if we don't deal with the actual emotion isn't a negative one. But if we don't deal with it, if we don't approach it in the positive way, then we might lash out, maybe not at the person who hurt us, but we'll lash out at our brothers or sisters or parents even. And we'll start to get angry and we start to hit everyone. You think, oh, where did that come from? But actually it's suppressing an emotion and taking it out in the wrong way. That's negative, okay? And, you know, even Prophet Muhammad, he talks, you know, he approaches emotions and he's had emotions and there's so many stories that we can learn from him. And even, you know, all of us, I'm sure, have studied the seerah or the life of Prophet Muhammad. And we know that there's a year in his life called Aam al-Huzn. And that's what it was described as by historians. Why? Because he struggled, he had so much sadness that year that he lost his wife and his uncle Abu Talib. That year was so sad for him that it became known as Aam al-Huzn. So the actual feeling of sadness is not actually related to not having faith. Don't think that. I think that's sometimes a negative stigma that people bring about, or that if you have faith, then you don't have any kind of sadness. You shouldn't feel sad or you shouldn't feel angry. It's not that at all. And the Prophet Muhammad is the best of all creations and he's an example to us all, and he faced sadness. And even, you know, the story of when he lost his son, Ibrahim, he said, indeed the eyes shed tears and the heart sorrows, but we do not say that which displeases Allah. And these words actually show that, yes, he has those feelings, that those feelings are there and we can come to them, but then accept the will of Allah. And he teaches us so much through those examples when he shares his feelings. So he's sharing it. He's not bottling it all inside. He's sharing those feelings, but he's also telling us, he's teaching us to be cautious of our words. And, you know, I've seen so many people in my line of work where they come and they face sometimes struggles and they face difficulty and they say, why Allah? Why me? Why do I have this? And then that may even lead to them becoming, astaghfirullah, angry at Allah. Why did this come to me? I've done so much good. Why has this happened to me? That's when the Prophet actually teaches us, be careful with your words. We do not say that which displeases Allah. Okay, so the actual emotion isn't bad. It's okay to feel sadness, but it's how you deal with it that's important. And even anger, people might say, oh, but anger, it's such a negative emotion. It's a horrible emotion. Not really. It's not at all. It's there in our fitra. It's part of our powers that we have, and it gives you bravery. And if you didn't have anger, you wouldn't go out and you wouldn't fight for people who are oppressed in this life. And it wouldn't give you the strength to speak up. Okay, so anger itself is a positive emotion as well. And we have to also realize that every suffering, every struggle that we might face, and we're facing a lot of struggles now in our lives, you know, so let's kind of take note of what's happening right now in the world. Every struggle has a positive potential outcome, okay, and it's all there to serve something for us if we actually choose to learn from the struggle. And Allah, we have so many hadith and says that Allah tests those who He loves, okay. And there's a hadith that says, "May yurid Allah an bihi khayran yusab minhu." So Allah tests you, because through those struggles you actually grow. And I've read so many stories of people who have struggled so much in their life. When I read some of the stories, I think, oh my goodness, how does this person able to survive this? But actually, some of them, when you listen to them and you read their books and you read their story, they come out on the other side and they say, I wouldn't change one thing of my past. I wouldn't change any of those struggles, whether they have been abused or anything else. They wouldn't change it. Why? Why do they say that? Because they found the learning in that. It's made them the strong person they are today. So when we are struggling now with lockdown and not being able to see our friends or even our family, yes, it's hurtful. Yes, it's painful. Yes, it makes us sometimes angry. Yes, we don't understand certain things. But let's try to take a different cognitive approach to it. You know, a different way of thinking. Remember those thoughts, feelings, emotions? Different way of thinking and saying, what does this want me to learn? What does the situation have for me to learn from? What can I learn from it? What can I appreciate from it? And so many of us took our life for granted before, our freedom for granted. And this is one of our biggest lessons right now. We don't take our freedom for granted. And so many people didn't have the pleasures that we had of going out whenever we wanted, of seeing our family or friends whenever we wanted. So let's try to, you know, look at what each situation, every difficulty that you might face, how can I deal with it? How can I deal with my emotion? Inshallah, we'll come to those. But equally, what does this situation have for me to learn from it? What is it giving me that I can learn from and then deal and appreciate and grow through it? It's all about growth. Every single year when you celebrate your birthday, I always say, not just celebrate your birthday with growing 1 year older, but what have you learned? How have you grown mentally, physically, everything in this year? That's what we should do. Every new year that's coming up, for example, every new year resolution, you should look back and think, how have I grown this year? What challenges did I tackle this year? What have I been able to overcome this year? And that takes me nicely to the point that I really want you to, if there's one thing that I want you to leave today, is actually this, and that's owning your emotion, taking full ownership of everything about yourself. I want you to realize that whatever you think, you've chosen to think that way. Whatever you feel, you've chosen to feel this way. And however you act, you have chosen to act that way. And we can hear sometimes adults even saying, that person made me angry. Or, you know, even our parents might say to us sometimes, you know, "Enta asabatni," or "you made me angry," or "you made me do this." You know, we say sometimes these things to, you know, our parents might say it to their children, or we say it to our friends, or we say it to people around us. But actually, that's not true. Okay, we say it, but actually what that does, it gives power to other people over us. And once you actually start to take ownership of your own thoughts, of your own emotions and your own action, you start to become really empowered from within, okay? And that takes a lot of self-knowledge. And, you know, one of the things that I was saying the other day is knowledge is power and self-knowledge is your ultimate superpower, or is empowerment, okay? So the more you start to really take control of what do I think? Where is this come from? Where is this thought come from? What do I feel about it? If you start to really look inside and gain more knowledge about yourself, you start to take ownership, okay? No one ever makes you feel sad. You have chosen to feel sad. No one actually makes you angry. You've chosen to be angry. And that's why you might have two people facing exactly the same situation. One of them will lash out and punch the other person. One of them will remain really calm. What has made that person act in that way and the other person act in a different way? It's not the environment. It's not other person in front of them, but it's your choice. Okay. So it's so important for every single one of us to actually make those choices, realize that we have a choice in every single aspect, take notice of it, be aware of it, and then take control of it and change it to what serves you best. Okay. So life is about choices, choosing your energy every single day. If you wake up and you feel like you lack energy today, do something that will boost your energy. Okay. If you feel like you have a bad thought today, and sometimes we do get those bad thoughts that come to our mind, be aware of it, suddenly take notice of it and stop it right there and say, okay, I know there's a thought there, but I can change it to a more empowering thought. I can change it to a more positive thought. Sometimes we don't notice our thoughts. They kind of go past and then suddenly we feel something inside. People usually feel, they don't realize the thought. As soon as you realize the feeling that you just don't feel yourself today, you don't feel happy today, or you don't feel energized today, take notice of that feeling straight away before it goes too much and try to change it. Do something that makes you happy. You know, if it's talking to a friend or calling a family member or maybe playing sports or, you know, opening a candle, buying some flowers, whatever it is that makes you feel happy, do that to change your state straight away. Choose your emotions, choose your actions every single time, okay? Once you've taken control of that and you make those choices, you become so empowered. So how do you take control of all these things, okay? Number one, there's five steps that I'm going to talk about today. Number one is belief. Belief is so important, okay? You have to believe from today that you can control all of these things about yourself. You can't control the world. You can't control a virus maybe, but what you can do is control yourself. So you have to believe that you can. And a lot of people don't do something because actually, and when you come back to, when you question them about their belief system, they don't believe they can. So number one, believe that you can. And actually go further to say, I have done it already. And that's something that a lot of coaches do as well. We kind of go as though you've achieved it already. So believe it as though you've done it already. You've controlled your thoughts, you've controlled your feelings, and you've controlled your actions. Number two, decide what you want your energy state to be every single day. Decide it. So even as soon as you wake up, decide, I'm going to be a 9 out of 10 energy level. I'm going to be, you know, happy and positive, and you're going to decide what you want to be. So believe you can, decide what you want. Number three, be aware. Always be aware. So every single time you feel something or you do something, just question yourself. You know, we sometimes notice so much about other people, but we don't notice things about ourselves. So just go back a bit and just be aware of it. Be aware of what made you do this? What made you say this? What made you feel this? What made you think this? Okay. Once you become aware, then you do number four, which is decide where that came from. So decide, having a think about, okay, I'm aware that I'm feeling a bit sad or I'm feeling angry or I'm feeling frustrated today. Just, you know, take a moment to decide, where has this come from? Question yourself. Is there something that someone said? Is there something that happened? Or is it just the bad weather? Where has this come from? Okay, because sometimes we just need to delve a bit deeper. That's why I say about self-knowledge is empowerment. Where is this emotion? Where is this feeling or thought come from? Once you realize where it's come from, then you can kind of portray to the world something new. You can choose then to be something different. You can choose to be something different, to do something different. Okay, so these are kind of the steps that I want you to take on. I want to show you two techniques that really, really will, inshallah, help you. Number one, I think a lot of you are probably aware of this or have heard of this before. Maybe you've even done it in school, and that's actually mindfulness. Okay. So I don't know if anyone, I really hope you guys have had your cameras on so you can just put your hands up and I can see you. But so mindfulness, what is it? Okay. There's no interaction here because I don't see everyone, but, mindfulness is about, or meditation is really about just being aware of being present. It helps you to become present in the moment, because what causes a lot of anxiety is when people are living in the future. And what causes a lot of depression is when people live in the past. So what really helps you with your well-being is just to be present now, present here, What do you have right now? How can I feel grateful right now? Gratitude as well. So let's talk about mindfulness and being present. And I want to do an exercise with you, if I can encourage you all to do that. I'm going to just ask it one more time, if you can open your cameras, just to get all the, you know, the boys and girls to see them. But I'll do this here. I can't see you, so I don't know if you're laughing or doing it properly. But let's try to maybe close our eyes for a moment. And just sit back, relax your shoulders, and sit back on your chair and just close your eyes for a moment. And I want you just to take a really deep breath in. Just take a really, really deep breath in through your nose and just let it out through your mouth. And you can maybe even put your hand on your stomach, on your tummy, and just feel the rise. And you want to take that breath just a lot deeper into your tummy there, and just see the rise in your tummy as you take another deep breath in through your nose and out through your mouth. And take another deep breath in, and as you do, just appreciating the moment that you're here right now, the opportunities that you have and everything you're grateful for in this present moment. And as you breathe out, letting go of any tension in your mind and your body. And just take one more deep breath in and out. And so this is one of the common techniques that a lot of, you know, people like me or, you know, healers will teach you. And the technique to breathing, the technique for mindfulness, there's so many techniques to it. What I usually teach is either the triangle method or the square method. What do I mean by that? So you breathe in for 4 seconds, breathe out for 4 seconds, and then you hold it in for 2 or 4 seconds, depending on where, how you feel. Or you can choose the square method, which is 4-2-4-2, whatever feels right to you. So the aim is just to really breathe it in for 4 seconds, hold it, breathe it out for 4 seconds. And you want to take that breath really deep rather than having shallow breathing, because when people struggle with mental health, usually their breathing becomes quite shallow. Okay. And maybe even in our side, I remember when I was training, they were saying, like, British society, a culture, we're so concerned with how we look and our tummy not sticking out that we actually breathe from our chest. And sometimes that's not, doesn't serve you. So if you learn to start breathing much deeper, and just allowing that tummy and diaphragm just to fully arise, that 360 sort of degree breathing technique, then you start to train yourself to breathe much deeper. And so when you are struggling with any anxiety, any depression, you're already trained. You've trained yourself to breathe in the right way. And so you can calm yourself down straight away through the breathing. There's so much magic in breathing. And that's why I wanted to teach you this today. So inshallah, you'll go and you'll practice this every single day. Don't do it just when you are struggling, because it won't be as helpful. If you practice this every single day, in the morning, in the evening, minimum, about 2-3 minutes each at the least, ideally a bit longer, and during the day if you can, it will really help you that when you do, if you do struggle, God forbid, then you have the capacity, because your body will know what to do, okay? Your body will respond because it's trained correctly, okay? The second example I wanted to do is also, I told Janan I wanted a snow globe, okay? And I searched, I even went to the shops and I searched for a snow globe, I couldn't find it. There's a reason why I wanted a snow globe, and I wanted to just show you a little strategy, sort of a visualization strategy that will just help you deal with emotions, okay? So what I want you to do is maybe close your eyes, and you all know what a snow globe is. I'm hoping you do. By the way, type in the chat box if you want. At least that's kind of a way to actually interact with you. So type in the chat box. Do you know, hope you all know what a snow globe is. It's one of those little globes that have snow inside, and when you shake them, the snow falls. So what I want you to do is, you can close your eyes or keep your eyes open and maybe focus on a point in the room. I want you to imagine yourself, you're inside a snow globe, okay? But it's a really, really big snow globe, and it's beautiful, okay? And maybe you have a tree next to you, and you're standing there, and there's snow falling on you. So maybe close your eyes and just really visualize that. You know, there's snow just coming down, just really gently on you. And you can see the trees around you, just little things that are inside your snow globe. And as the snowflakes start to fall on you, just imagine them being like different emotions that are coming at you. Just different emotions. And some of these emotions or snowflakes are just pretty ones, and they're nice ones, and they're healthy ones, and they're okay. Some of them might not be so helpful or so serving, might not make you feel okay. So as those snowflakes fall on you, they might want to just stick onto your head or your shoulders or even your hands. And what I want you to do is just take notice of those emotions or those snowflakes on you and just shake them off a bit. Just literally just go like this and just shake them off. Okay? Imagining those emotions coming at you, and you know they're there. And when you can, just shake them off. Some of them will fall naturally, and some of them you just need to shake them off. But then there might be some snowflakes that are quite stubborn. So some might be stuck onto your shoulders or your clothes, and they might even go inside your clothes and just be a bit wet and horrible. And with those emotions that stick on you, or those snowflakes that are stuck on you, just allow them to sit there maybe. Just take a moment, just allow them to be there, if they want to be there. And just allow them just to easily, slowly melt away. If they're okay, sometimes they're okay for them to be there. And it's just the natural process of it being there. And once you're aware of them, once you're okay with them, just take a moment and allow them just to melt away at their own time. Because that's what emotions are. Sometimes there are emotions that will glide away naturally. Sometimes there are emotions that we need to shake off, and we can do that. And sometimes there are emotions that we just need to stick with, and they're okay, they want to stick with us. And we just need to sit with them. Just take a moment to sit with your emotions sometimes and just allow them to be there, rather than trying to shake them just away if they don't want to be shaken away. Just take a moment to sit there. Once they're ready, they'll go away. Okay. When you're ready now, if you've got your eyes closed, just maybe open them up. So I usually do a different way. I usually do it with monkeys on a car, but today we decided to do it in snowflake because we're in Christmas and December time. And sometimes it's okay. Sometimes we can brush off certain things, by the way. Some of them, we don't find it so easy to brush away. And that's why sometimes we need to sit with emotions. And I've done that with a lot of people as well, where they might have grief or other really heavy emotions that they're not able just to shake off. So sometimes we do exercises where we sit with emotions, and sometimes it's good to have a professional to help you with those, because if you don't sit with an emotion, it's a bit like a ball where you're trying to put it in water, you know, those like little beach balls. And what you want to do is you're trying to push it into the water, but what it wants to do, it keeps wanting to come out, and you try to push it in and it wants to come out, but you're not letting it just sit. Sometimes it just needs to sit on the water. Okay, so just allowing that comfortable, safe space for it to be there, just to notice it, and eventually it will just glide away. But suppressing it actually does no good. So that's why sometimes it's really important to reach out. So don't fear, don't have any worry about reaching out when certain emotions you can't shake away. Because we all need that, okay? We all need that support. And, you know, Allah has told us that to every illness, there's a cure. So it's about just seeking that cure. And I don't, you know, it's not about just physical illnesses. Mental illnesses are real. And if we don't seek the right help, we don't seek the right support, then we just end up having that bubble. We're trying to suppress it, but it wants to come out, and it will come out in the wrong way, okay? Sadness, if it's suppressed, it might come out as anger, you know? And we see that sometimes. Someone's upset us, and we're so sad about it, and we cry about it. And so when somebody comes and talks to us, we suddenly get really angry, and we start to scream at them. So every emotion is a positive emotion, but when we try to suppress it, when we don't deal with it, it comes out as a different emotion sometime, and it actually serves no one. It doesn't serve you. It doesn't serve anyone around you as well. The other thing I'll hear from all of you, and I'll ask any questions as well, is I wanted to just remind you some of the techniques that we have in Islam. We're so privileged, alhamdulillah, to have our religion as the biggest, you know, help that we can seek. And, you know, so I've mentioned so much of I've already mentioned the story of Prophet Muhammad. And we know, you know, Prophet Yaqub faced a lot of grief with his son when Yusuf was taken away, you know, was taken away from him. And it had a physical impact on him, where his eyes went too wide, no? بيضت عيناه من الحزن. And these kind of emotions are there, and if we don't deal with them, they do actually take a physical effect on us. And they're okay. So, you know, all of these things are okay, but it's about seeking and reaching out. And some of the things that, you know, Islam teaches about regulating emotions, one of the techniques, for example, when we're angry, the Prophet says, if you're sitting down, stand up. If you're standing up, sit down. Or go do wudu. All of those strategies actually help us to deal with it. And we've done this as well, you know, as part of my NLP training. I remember them teaching us, like, if you can't deal with an emotion or your thought, then change your physiology, you know. Changing the physiology, changing your action, thoughts, feelings, emotion. If you don't notice the thought, it goes to the feeling, you can't help the feeling, then at least your action. So change your physiology, stand up, sit down. All of these physiology actually changes the rest of the things. The other one is self-care. The Prophet has, you know, so many hadith, and the Imams have taught us about self-care, eating the right things, exercising, all of those self-care routine. And the only person, don't ever expect people to look after you more than how you look after yourself. Don't ever be dependent on anyone, you know, having your back if you don't have your own back, you know. Reach out to yourself, help yourself rather than depending on people to help you up. So seek help, go ask for someone. Don't wait for someone to come to you, you know. Don't wait for someone to save you. Save yourself by reaching out to people. And, you know, prayers is such a beautiful thing, you know. The Prophet, when he used to ask Bilal to do the adhan, he says, Arihna ya Bilal, comfort us, Bilal. And that's because he was connected to the prayers. He was connected almost like that mindfulness that we talked about. That's his time of meditation. It's time where you can leave life and all its struggles and all its worries, and you just connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is the source of all good in this life, you know. So prayers is such a beautiful thing that helps us. And the Quran, you know, ala bi dhikrillah tatma'innul qulub, just taking time out just to really connect yourself with the Quran, with the words of Allah, gives you that comfort and that rest inside of you. So inshallah, all of these kind of techniques, whether it's religious or even visualization or the mindfulness, has helped you to deal with some of the emotions. And of course, if anyone has any worries, please do reach out, you know, get my number from Jinan, or if anyone needs anything, just reach out either through, you know, talk to your parents, talk to your friends, or talk to a professional that can help you. Inshallah, I wish you all the best. So please, anyone has any comment or questions or what you thought about the exercises, please share either through messages or open your mics. I would probably have imagined it to be, if you're breathing in colors, you'd probably be breathing in green and breathing out red, because usually the red is associated with a bit more of a fiery sort of emotion. But, you know, whatever serves you. I always think with these visualizations, they're brilliant. So when I do mindfulness, even when I do it with my clients, I always start actually every session with an energy boost. And then we do some mindfulness and affirmations every single session at the start of it. And I encourage everyone to do this every single day, by the way. So when you're doing mindfulness, it's always so positive. So I did a very, very quick one now, but it's always actually positive to visualize positive feelings. So visualize like goodness coming your way. So you know how I said, breathing in the current moment, breathing in what you feel, all the goodness in your life, breathing in the, you breathe in all the good. So if you imagine those, whatever good you have in this world, even, and just imagine you're breathing all that in, or what good you want as well, because sometimes you might not have it yet. You might want something, but you don't have it yet. Breathe it in as though you have it already. And you start to visualize yourself actually being it. Okay. Once you breathe in and you let go, when you breathe out, so you say, for example, the cool technique that you said of breathing out a color. So you can actually breathe out any tension. And that's why I said tension is somewhat, sometimes it holds us back. And sometimes just connecting when you with your breathing is so powerful. And sometimes when I do this for a very long period of time, I did it with a group once, who, like I said, charity group, and they wanted me to talk about overwhelm within the charity of the volunteers. And we did, you know, a longer mindfulness technique. And I remember one of the feedback that somebody said to the organizer said, it's the first time that I felt I've ever breathed properly. I actually feel like I'm breathing now. And breathing is an automatic thing that we do in our body, but it's actually so powerful when you become so much more conscious of it and when you do it consciously. So visualization, there's so much techniques to visualization. And, you know, one of the snow globe is just a technique that I taught you, but there's so much things. There's another one where you're in a car and you have like monkeys coming on your window and you can kind of swipe them off and all of those techniques. There's so many visualizations that you can actually create yourself. And there's so much out there, by the way. So feel free to go onto YouTube and search them as well. And people can do this in different ways, by the way. So journaling, what does it mean? So journal how you feel as well, not just what you want. Sometimes we're so bogged down with writing a list of what we want to do, but we don't actually write how we want to be or how you feel that day. Just journaling sometimes your emotions or energy state, okay? Journaling what's gone well. I always encourage people to do gratitude journal as well. Gratitude, you know, is so, so powerful. And maybe inshallah Monday we can talk about gratitude on its own, because it's one of the real healing methods and it actually helps you to appreciate the current moment when you are thankful, not just by saying thank you, but feeling it, feeling grateful for everything that you have. It allows you to focus on the positive things rather than the things that you don't have, okay? Because even with kids sometimes they say they've got all these toys about around them and then one of them say, but I don't have this. And we notice those because we're, as humans, sometimes we have a bias towards negativity, but we can actually choose something else. We can change that, okay? Definitely. So that's one of the techniques that actually we did. I actually did it the other day with one of the clients. So some of the, with the children, actually, I use that as well. And I even adults, to be honest. So writing sometimes a story that has happened to you. So I did that today with a story, not just an emotion. So something that might have happened in the past, because a lot of our anxieties, a lot of our worries, depression is actually related to things in the past. And it might be a small event, but we kind of explode it to something so big in our mind. So taking a moment to writing it out on a piece of paper, not in your journal, something that you can rip up, writing it out and then reading it once or twice. Okay, read it out loud to yourself. And sometimes another technique that I do is actually put some funny music in the background when you read it. And it just, instead of that big image in your mind, it just starts to make itself a bit smaller and a bit more funny. And then what you do, once you've read it, once you've, you know, kind of sat with that story or that emotion or that feeling that you've got, then take a moment just to rip it off and really, really rip it out into small pieces and just throw it out in the room, okay? And you can blame me if the parents tell you off with that, okay? But literally throw it away. And it almost gives you that feeling that you're letting go of it. So these are all another visualization techniques like we've done with the snowflakes. So another one where you physically actually hold something and you throw it out. Or maybe you might want to go into, if you've got like a seaside next to you, as long as it's not considered littering, you can throw it out into the sea or throw it out into the bin or burn it away, you know, whatever it might be, but just letting go of something that's not serving you. These are all choices, anything. So sometimes people have asked me as well, a really, really good question, where do I need to get rid of every negative emotion? And the question to ask yourself is that serving me? If a thought isn't serving you, then get rid of it. If it's serving you, that's why with every client I have always, I always have to kind of look at, is it serving them? Is it doing well for them? If it's going positive for them, then why change it? Why get rid of it? But if it's not serving you, get rid of it. Let go. So again, it's the physiology. So you're changing your physiology and you're actually, the feeling of water is actually very soothing. Okay. There is so much healing in water. Okay. And especially, by the way, there's a lot of techniques that they use with cold water. So not even warm water. And I haven't done this. I don't do this because I find it really, really horrible. But one of the techniques to actually really help with mental health is they encourage you to have a really cold, ice cold bath or a really ice cold shower. And some people do this every single day, by the way, because it's so soothing and it energizes your brain and it creates so many new pathways in your brain that it's actually really positive. So although it's that technique where you're putting water on your body and it's usually, if you do it with cold water and just allow that water to be, don't wipe it off, you know, don't take it away, just let it be there. And you're changing that state because usually what we do when we're annoyed, we just want to sit down, we want to cuddle, we want to comfort ourselves. And even though that feeling is uncomfortable, we just sit with it. So just snapping out of that, doing something differently will itself in itself help, and water is a healer as well. So that's why they are kind of doing two things in one. And with wudu and ghusl, by the way, there is such a big spiritual aspect. So even when we do ghusl, for example, if you go into the shower, just almost like visualizing your dhunub falling off. Or, you know, that's part of it. That's why they do ghusl al-jum'ah. You know, there's the hadith that say ghusl al-jum'ah, you know, the Friday wash actually wipes away your sins for that week. So that's why if you do your ghusl every single Friday, it actually wipes away the sins of every single week. And it's really nice when you're actually doing it to actually visualize those sins falling off. Okay, so as you say, with the wudu, there's that physical aspect of it where you're moving, where you're putting cold water, but also just using that emotion when you're doing that motion, just wiping away those negativity or the dhunub or any feeling that's not serving you or any anger that you might have, just wiping them all off away. So definitely a spiritual aspect to it. Everything we do, by the way, we can always, and it's really, really helpful to connect with the spirituality aspect of it. It's actually, there in all of us, and that's why we call it an ego, okay? And I don't mean the ego. So anyone who doesn't know what an ego is, it's that, what you want to call it. You know, whatever, how I don't mean the ego, the kind of in psychology terms, what Freud talked about, but that self, that negative almost self. And the ego works through fear, okay? It acts through fear. Fear of, oh, what will people think of me? Or fear of, oh, I'm going to be, you know, looked down upon, or all of those. So the ego takes control, and actually sometimes you just need to be aware of the ego, okay? And pride is there. And sometimes when we talk about even self-love, a lot of people think that when we talk about self-love or self-care, it's actually selfish. Or when people actually have confidence, sometimes people see confidence in the wrong way. They think, oh, but that's arrogance. And I always say, you know, the difference between confidence and arrogance is intention, okay? So if you have the intention to be like you're above everyone else, that's arrogance. But if you feel confident and you're actually with someone else, you don't have the intention to be above, to annoy everyone, then that's confidence. That's a good thing to have. So, you know, pride and the ego and all of these kind of things will be there. It's about taking notice. Again, self-knowledge. Really take notice of it and then set your intention correct and say, I can't control what people say to me. I can't control what people do to me, but I can control how I react to them. And I will always act in my own akhlaq and my own standard. I will never go down to someone else's standard. Okay, that's the most important thing, because there will always be people that will swear at you, lie to you, talk behind your back, all of these things. There will always be these kind of people in the world. And how you respond to it is the main thing. Do you respond at their level? If they swear at you, do you swear back? If they hit you, do you hit back, or do you stay at your standard? You think, I'm not going to go down to your standard. Okay. So just be aware of yourself, what your set your intention, and fight that ego. Okay. When it's telling you don't back away, you say, I'm going to back away. Okay. If it tells you don't apologize, I'm going to apologize. I'm going to show them. I'm going to show that ego how strong I am. And however that person wants to take it, they can take it however they want, because I know what my intention is. Okay.